Welcome everyone to today's session, Designing Staffing Models for Fluctuating Volumes. My name is Derek Locke and I'm with Healthcare Call Center Times. If you would like to tweet during this presentation, please use hashtag the contact experience. After the presentation, we'll answer questions from attendees. To ask a question, please click on the Ask a Question button under the session Q&A tab on the right side of the screen. It's my pleasure to introduce today Lou Iacovani. Lou is Senior Director, Medicare Sales for Geisinger Health Plan, Geisinger Indemnity Insurance Company, and Geisinger Quality Options, Incorporated. Lou is responsible for GHP's Medicare Sales Call Center, Member Retention, Employed Outside Sales Team, and External Broker Relationships. Lou joined the Geisinger Health Plan in 2003 and has made a valued impact in growing Geisinger Gold membership, improving Net Promoter Score to best in class, retaining 95% of members, and has restructured the sales department to improve conversion and employee satisfaction. Prior to joining Geisinger Health Plan, he was Director of Sales and Customer Service at Kemper Direct Auto and Home Insurance. Lou holds a Bachelor of Science in Business Logistics from Penn State University Smeal College of Business and holds a Six Sigma Yellow Belt accreditation. Also today is Tom Gleason. Tom's role at Dial America is to introduce client companies to Dial America's full service contact center capabilities. With over 28 years in the contact center industry, Tom will discuss the development and successful evolution of FlexForce, an innovative staffing approach to ensure full agent coverage during peak times, while avoiding idle agents during lower call volume periods. And now I'll turn it over to the session to Tom to begin the presentation.
Well, thank you for that introduction, and we appreciate you joining our session, Designing Staffing Models for Fluctuating Volumes. If you're interested in scheduling efficiencies or cost savings or improved performance, you're in the right place today. Again, my name is Tom Gleason, Vice President of Customer Solutions for Dial America. And I'm joined by Lou Iacovani, Director of Medicare Sales for Geisinger Health Plan. You all know Lou from his leadership in our industry, and we're looking forward to a great presentation today.
Yeah, thanks for that, Tom. Looking forward to being here and answering any questions that anyone has. We're more than happy to give you any insights we can to assist as we go forward.
Terrific. And during the live Q&A session, we'll also be joined by Dennis McHugh, Senior Vice President of Workforce Optimization for Dial America. So we look forward to having your questions and your input during our presentation today. So to get started, I thought I would put up some areas of focus that many of us in the healthcare contact center industry face every day. Whether it's spikes in call volume or costs, call quality, could be compliance issues or investing in new technology, whether it's speech analytics or gamification or anything in the AI space, those may be areas that you're focusing on. So we'd love to get your input and hear what are some of the issues that you're facing today. Lou, I know this is on your radar and would love to hear some of the things that you're looking at today.
Yeah, thanks, Tom. We look at all of these things, and we also look at a lot of things that CMS holds us responsible for, such as our abandonment rate. We have to have abandonment rates less than 5%. So we need to make sure that we are staffed appropriately so that we are under 5%. My job is responsible for Medicare Contact Center. So what that means is we have huge fluctuations in call volumes. As you can imagine, especially during our annual enrollment period, everybody's used to seeing a lot of those commercials between October and December, right? Now's the time you can change your annual enrollment. So just as an example, our sales call center goes from about 2,500 calls per month from January through August. It jumps to about 3,500 in September. October and November were well over 20,000 calls. So as you can imagine, that gets very expensive and it gets really tricky. And we've been very lucky to have a long partnership with Tom and his group. And they assist us to make sure that not only are we answering all of those calls, but we're answering them in a cost-effective manner. And that's critical for us, as not only we have to worry about answering the calls, but we have to make sure that the quality is high. And in a sales and retention environment, we also handle the retention piece. We need to make sure that we can convert as many members as possible, and we need to keep as many members as possible. So it's really that entire balance of answering the call in a timely fashion, making sure we are giving prompt and courteous service, and then obviously able to write or keep a member in every aspect that we can.
In order to address, of course, who is on this presentation today, actually did some research on block scheduling and found that it was Henry Ford back in 1914 who developed the 8-hour, 5-day-a-week scheduling. This was really a relief for his workers who were working day and night, 7 days a week, and he was looking for ways to improve productivity as well as reduce attrition and increase employee satisfaction. So while this was great for Henry Ford in 1914, block scheduling is still being used today. Full-time schedules are really an easier way for an organization to drop workers into those 8-hour schedules. And so today what we'd like to do is introduce some new concepts that we think will be helpful to you and your organization, and hopefully will be better for the worker and be better for your costs and your efficiencies. So another concept during busy times is actually outsourcing to organizations who might be able to help your company during busy times. Even Michelangelo in 1508 used outsourced artists to help him with the monumental task of painting the Sistine Chapel. And just like employers today, Michelangelo was looking for artists who embraced his culture, trained the way he liked to be trained, and also carry on the excellence that he had with the brand recognition of being Michelangelo. So those are important concepts that that even today's workers are looking for in terms of having a groundbreaking solution for block scheduling that would enable those workers to have flexible schedules and also complete the work that needs to be done. One of the concepts in the thin sourcing that Dial America provides to our clients is really that thin line between the client and Dial America, so that we are embracing the culture. We are training our agents the way the employer trains their agents. So it's a true collaboration. Lou, you probably have some thoughts on thin sourcing and how that's impacted your organization.
Yeah, for sure, Tom. You know, when we work with Dial and with your company, we always say to the agents when they're answering the phone, you're Geisinger. You're not Dial America. When that phone rings, we want you to be Geisinger. We do not want the customer, the prospect, the member on the other end of the phone to think anything other than you're Geisinger and you're going to be there for them. So whether the phone rings and it's answered by a Geisinger employed person who's been with us for a number of years or one of your agents, we want that to be seamless. So this thin sourcing model really works very well for us. At the end of the day, if that person calls in and they get a Dial America agent or they get a Geisinger fully employed agent, we don't want them to know the difference. So it's critical for us to make sure that we continue to deliver an excellent experience. In fact, we strive and we really push hard to get our Net Promoter Score at a number that's above 60. And as all of you know, customer service and member services and the way that you handle calls is critical to keep that score up. Because one of the first things that people will say if and when they leave, is they'll say, I had a terrible member experience or a terrible phone experience. So we never want to give them that opportunity to say that. So at the end of the day, it is critical for us to have that moment of truth, always be positive, and always remember that when we're talking to someone, it's the most important person at that time, and just really concentrate and be in the moment and be there for that person. So absolutely, Tom, something that we talk about all the time when we're training our staff and your staff.
Great, thank you, Lou. So one of the important aspects of thin sourcing is what Dial America calls flex force, which is the variable-based scheduling. This is really a way to make scheduling more efficient, cost-effective, and it also shapes the work of the employees, really enabling them to have their own schedules, control of their schedules, control of their environment. And we're going to talk more about that in a little while, but the flex force has been a great success for a number of clients, including Blue Cross Blue Shield of Minnesota. In the case of Blue Cross, they were looking for Dial America to augment another vendor's work for sales and service calls during AEP. And as you can see by this graph, the forecasted need is the orange line. And Dial America's flex force scheduling is the blue line, which actually contours almost perfectly with the forecasted need. The full-time scheduling that you see is actually what the vendor was proposing for Blue Cross of Minnesota. The other vendor had block scheduling, full-time agents, and you can see the gaps there. You can see the inefficiencies in an eight-hour day that are presented by this type of scheduling. So we actually, in the case of Minnesota, they anticipated us staffing about 125 FTEs. We had quite a few less than that and actually saved Minnesota about $250,000 over a 12-week period. So quite a success story there for that organization. Now, COVID has actually shown a spotlight on employee satisfaction and how organizations can keep their workforce satisfied. One of the things that this shows is that employee productivity and even employee mental wellness have become issues in the contact center that many management personnel have to deal with on a daily basis. So, everyone in our industry is looking for ways to keep employees satisfied. And one of the ways that that can be done is with the variable scheduling. The concept is called work shaping, where you're actually involving the employees, empowering them to control their schedules, and in that case, giving them lower attrition, engagement at work, and even higher levels of performance, which is some of what our clients have mentioned to us. Lou, curious about your thoughts on work shaping.
Yeah, you know, Tom, even if you could just go back to that previous slide for a second, because I had some thoughts around it. So if you look at this previous slide, right, this is really critical. So employee satisfaction at work, we do an employee survey every year. And a lot of times, you know, there's a lot of things that can be involved with it. But one of the things is hours worked and what are your hours of operation. So what I can tell you is we're open 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. That's our call center hours. And that's Monday through Friday from December 8th till October 1st. But then we're open 7 days a week, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. from October 1st to December 7th. And we used to have some issues because of weekend staffing. And as you can imagine, that was a real negative for some of our employees. In working with Tom and his group, they were able to take those weekend staffing hours for us. And it allowed us actually to improve our employee satisfaction. So the beauty of that model, that thin sourcing model, and those flat curve, if you will, from the hours that are needed, is we're also able to improve our employee engagement survey. And this has definitely been very powerful for us to use because people know what their schedule is. They know that that schedule isn't going to change and that it really helps us to be a partner with Dial because then they know also what calls that they're going to be getting on what days and what hours. So it's it truly is a win-win. So I think that the block scheduling is what we deal with here at Geisinger. And if you can work with somebody that can fill in those gaps, especially whether it be weekend or nights or early morning or whatever your needs are, I think it really would help not only in having the right amount of people to answer the right amount of calls, but it'll also improve the current workforce that you have.
Great. Thank you, Lou. I appreciate that input. Next, we're looking at Geisinger's case study. This is for the most recent work that we've done for Geisinger. And Geisinger has been a client since 2011. Lou and his team do a great job, and we help to support the sales team during AEP. As you look at this particular graphic, you'll see the orange bars are the gains in efficiency with variable scheduling versus the blue bars, which are the full-time schedules, the block scheduling that is the alternative. And so we've been able to demonstrate to Geisinger some great efficiencies and savings, actually 2,000 billable hours over an 11-week period. So Lou, your comments on the FlexForce scheduling.
Yeah, so this truly is that bell curve that I talked about earlier, right? So you can see week one, that's where we're really just finishing up training and getting those agents on the phone and calls are just starting to pick up. Week two is obviously calls are picking up a little bit more. And then really from week three on through week 10, that's our annual enrollment period. That's where, Dial is taking as many phone calls as our internal staff. That's where it's critical to make sure that we have the right staff at the right time. So if you look at those differences really between the 997 and 1237 as an example in week three, if we were to block schedule those, that's where we would have 1,237 people, which means that you're going to be overstaffed in the hours probably between 8 a.m. and let's say 9:30 a.m. and you're going to be overstaffed between 6 p.m. and 8 p.m. But if you can get the right amount of people in those staff pretty even throughout those 12 hours, that's how it gets down to 997 versus the 1237. And as Tom said, you know, we do a really good job of looking at the details when it comes to the hours of what time the calls are coming in. So those inbound call forecasts are critical for us, because we know that, we're certainly going to be getting more calls between, let's say, 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. and certainly less calls between 8 and 10 and 6 to 8. So that arrival pattern is critical. So whatever you're doing in your call center, I would say you need to look at not only the day of the week, right? Everybody knows Monday is a much busier day than Thursday or Friday. And also that call time arrival pattern is critical as well. And if you have gaps like we have, you will notice that you'll be able to save a large chunk of hours and also be able to just staff correctly. The last thing you want is to have agents sitting around waiting for the phone to ring. That's, that could be a little bit demoralizing as well. So if you're overstaffed in those hours when it's not busy, that's not necessarily a good thing either for you or for your agent. And one thing that I always say is happy agents make happy customers. So you want to make sure that, you know, you're working and listening to your agents and that they're giving you the feedback as well. So this has really been a success for us. And we hone in on this every year and we make changes every year. And we think we get closer and closer to perfecting it. But it's really important for us as we enter every AEP. We look at what the marketing forecasts are. And again, we look at those arrival patterns and it makes a really big difference as we move forward. So definitely something, Tom, that we spend a lot of time on. And I think it shows here in the amount of hours that were saved and in our net promoter score to make sure that people, they know what it is that we would like delivered. So yeah, thanks so much for you and your team for helping us through and making sure that everything is where it's supposed to be.
Thank you, Lou. Great insight. We've got one more case study after we talk about a little bit about efficiency. And again, we'd love to have your input during the presentation or afterward. Are you looking at utilization or handle time? Do you measure efficiency with first call resolution or even cost per transaction? Lou, curious what your organization looks at in this area.
Yeah, for us, Tom, what I would say we look at, and we look at things a little bit differently. Average handle time for us is important, but we don't have a timer on the screen. We don't say you only have 5 minutes to get through this call. At the end of the day, we want that customer to be satisfied. When that agent hangs up the call, we really want them to think, was that a good call? Was that a good member touch point that I had that delivered that call? So for us, we look at things like average hold time. That's a big one for us. Nobody really likes to be on hold. So if we can minimize our hold time, that's really important. We also look at the quality of the call. So there's specific measurements we put in place to make sure that the agents are hitting on the things that they're hitting on. And for us, at the end of the day, it's really about conversion. And conversion is how many new members did we get at the end of the campaign, and how many members did we retain? So I think both of those are critical, as that really is where the rubber meets the road. We look at, okay, here's how many calls we got. Here's what the conversion was on those calls, whether it was a new prospect or it was a current member calling in. Did that member decide to stay with us? And I'm happy to say that, our membership retention this year, which Tom and his group has assisted us in as well, is over 97%. It's the highest it's ever been. So, it's a combination of making outbound calls to those members who we think are most likely to leave. And it's also pointing inbound calls as well, as we send out very specific email and regular mail pieces to them with specific toll-free numbers coming back in, so that the agent knows what the current plan that member is in, and in some cases even knows what county they're calling from. So all of that is critical to us as we make sure that we are hitting the metrics that we have in place. Again, it's different for every organization. But for us, it's all about, that moment of truth, making sure that the member sticks around and that we're converting as much as we can without pressure and without making either the agent or the member or the prospect feel uncomfortable. So I think, again, you need to look at what's important to you and your company and tie it back in.
Terrific. Thank you, Lou. And really would love those of you watching today to actually send us your thoughts on efficiency as we move forward in the presentation. As I mentioned, we've got one final case study. This one, although it's non-healthcare related, it's of interest, I think, because it's a client that we've had since 2005, and this bank utilizes our service on a year-round basis. So you can see fluctuations week by week, and that's usually driven by mail drops or digital advertising. But in this case, you're seeing the efficiencies. The orange bars are the efficient variable scheduling versus what the difference between that and the full-time scheduling that you see in the blue bars. So this is a client that we actually have been able to gain about 26% efficiency over time. In the case of the 7-week cycle that you saw there on the graph, it was about 4,800 billable hour savings that we've been able to deliver to this client. And on an annual basis, that's about 33,000 fewer billable hours. So quite an impact on that organization. Now, kind of in conclusion, wanted to talk about some takeaways from today's session, and that being really the things that we think you and your organization can enjoy as a result of looking at a variable schedule: enhanced efficiency, certainly more productive hours and less idle time for the agents, improved performance. The agents are certainly fresher and energized with full and part-time schedules being mingled together, and then certainly reduce costs. As we mentioned in the case of the bank, those 33,000 hours a year translate into about $800,000. So quite a bit of savings for that organization versus utilizing the full-time scheduling. Lou, any thoughts on the variable workforce?
Yeah, so, Tom, one thing I'll say is, I've had an opportunity to work with hundreds of Dial agents, and for whatever reason, it works great when you bring somebody in. Probably the biggest positive comment I get is, I really enjoy my flexible schedule. So, the people you're hiring, I think that it's a great fit for them, and it's a great fit for us as the client, because you're able to be really flexible as our needs ramp up and as the timing needs come in. So I really believe that it's a great win-win, because it just seems, again, from our standpoint, we tend to be more rigid in the fact that people, they have their hours and they like their hours and they really don't want their hours to change. Yet your team works really well with being flexible and working together. And I just want to make one other comment. I remember when I saw the Sistine Chapel, and by the way, I was actually there a few years ago, and it's breathtaking. So if you haven't been there, it's truly moving. So I highly recommend it. And I never knew that Michelangelo actually insourced some additional painters in there, because when you look up and you look around at the walls and the ceilings, you couldn't tell the difference between what he did and what any of his apprentices do or did. So, that's what we want at the end of the day. We want to make sure that it's seamless for our agents. It's seamless really at the end of the day for our members and for our prospects. And I think having that right mix and that right balance is critical to any organization to move forward. So thanks for that, Tom.
Yep, thank you, Lou. So in conclusion, in terms of the variable workforce, in terms of your organization, certainly we're glad to answer any questions. Would love to have your input in our live Q&A during this session and following the session. So we do want to make sure in closing that you complete the survey. We'd be very valuable for us to get your feedback on how the session went and if there's interest in this topic in the future. So again, greatly appreciate your attending the presentation today, and look forward to your input and your questions following this presentation.
Yeah, thank you so much, Tom. Thanks for having me. Appreciate given our insights to how this works. And again, if you can fill out that survey, we would be very appreciative of it. And obviously we're here to answer any questions you have. So thank you so much, everyone, for your time and attention.